Before we can build with nature, it is important to understand key factors in the formation and functioning of ecosystems. An ecosystem is a local network of different organisms such as plants, animals and microorganisms that live in interaction with each other and with their non-living abiotic environments. I will now discuss six abiotic factors that largely determine the abiotic boundary conditions for ecosystem development in coastal and riverine areas. If we take a very large spatial scale, the first factor that determines ecosystem development is temperature. For example, most mangrove species do not tolerate temperatures below 0 degrees Celsius. And reef-building corals can't tolerate water temperatures below 18 degrees Celsius. We can roughly distinguish three climatic zones: a polar zone, a temperate zone, and a tropical zone, each zone having its own characteristic ecosystems. If we zoom in to a more detailed scale, the second main determinant of ecosystem type is salinity. Ecologists distinguish the following salinity classes, namely fresh, brackish, and saltwater ecosystems. Each of these environments is inhabited by different species, dependent on their salinity tolerance. The salinity tolerance of some species is very narrow, and for others, such as salmon or eel, it is very broad. Along coasts, riverbanks and lakeshores, a third determinant is wave exposure. Systems with limited wave exposure, so-called sheltered systems, are dominated by fine sediments. A salt marsh is an example of an ecosystem that requires a sheltered environment. In wave-exposed areas, mostly sandy or rocky shores occur. A fourth abiotic factor relevant to ecosystem development is submergence time. Submergence time is reflected in tidal zonation. The lower tidal area that is constantly submerged is termed subtidal. Here we can find seagrasses and coral reefs. The upper area that is rarely submerged is called the supratidal area. Here we can find species that can tolerate an occasional salty bath, such as the purple sea lavender. The area in between is the intertidal. This area is air exposed during low tides and submerged during high tides. Oysters and mussels are able to live in this area as they can tightly close their shells to withstand low tide dryness. The fifth important abiotic factor is light availability. This factor is a strong determinant of the formation of ecosystems, particularly in water. Corals and submerged plants, such as seagrasses, depend on light to perform photosynthesis. Light availability in water is correlated with the water depth and turbidity. The amount of light-absorbing materials in the water is turbidity. In clear and shallow waters, light availability is high, promoting the formation of coral reefs, seagrass beds, and other types of submerged vegetation. Finally, the sixth important abiotic factor is nutrient availability. Inorganic nutrients and minerals such as nitrogen, phosphorus, and iron are necessary for the growth and survival of plants and phytoplankton. The amount of nutrients in the system can depend on the soil type, the upwelling of nutrient-rich deep waters, and river runoff. Systems with a high amount of nutrients are termed eutrophic, and systems with a low amount of nutrients are termed oligotrophic. These systems are usually associated with clear water. We have distinguished six abiotic factors that determine the abiotic boundary conditions for ecosystem development in coastal and riverine areas: temperature, salinity, wave exposure, submergence time, light availability, and nutrient availability. These factors can vary greatly over different seasons. In particular, temperature and the availability of light and nutrients can vary from summer to winter. The six abiotic factors and their seasonal variations primarily determine which species are able to survive at a specific locality. So, they determine what type of ecosystem can develop. In practice, this means that not every ecosystem can be created everywhere, simply because we are not able to control all these abiotic factors. However, if abiotic conditions are suitable, we can use ecosystem functions for building with nature. Oyster reefs and coral reefs, for instance, are effective in breaking waves. And seagrass beds and salt marshes and mangrove forests are very effective in protecting sediment against erosion. The appropriate ecosystems to consider in a building with nature design process will depend on both the abiotic boundary conditions and the desired functions of the ecosystems within your engineering design.